We're starting a brand new series today called Coram Deo. Coram Deo, C-O-R-A-M-D-E-O. Is it behind me on the screen? All right, Coram Deo. It is a Latin phrase translated in the presence of God. In the presence of God. In Christian theology, it summarizes the idea of Christians living in the presence of God, under the authority of God, and to the honor and glory of God. I mean, that in and of itself is a deep statement. To live our lives for the honor and for the glory of God. That's a heavy statement. Today, I promise you, there is going to be so much content that you are going to want to go back and watch this one online. Okay, you can do that on our app, and you can do that on our website, you can do it on YouTube. You can, if you have Fire Stick, we have a Fire Stick channel, or a Fire TV channel, so you can find us on the Fire Stick as well, all right? The root word of Coram is the word Cora, C-O-R-A. And Cora in the Latin means the pupil of the eye. The pupil of the eye. So the literal translation of Coram Deo is before the eyes of God. Before the eyes of God, and how appropriate that we're going into 2020 year, that we would live a year before the eyes of God. I'm just asking you today, do you have a 2020 vision for your new year? Are you ready to live a year before the eyes of God? At Family Church, we're not only committed to the month of January being our topic, but we are committed to the entire year of 2020. I'm not going to preach the same sermon series, but the idea that everything we do will be done before the eyes of God or in the presence of God. I want to share with you a scripture in the book of Psalm. This is David singing out of a heart to speak to the Lord. And this is what he says in Psalm 139:7. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? And what's the answer to that question? Nowhere. Nowhere. He's poetically speaking. He's pretty much saying, there's nowhere I can go from your spirit. There's nowhere I can flee from your presence. Watch what he says. If I go up into heaven, you are there. That one's easy for us to believe. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light becomes night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. He got night vision goggles. The night will shine like day, for darkness is as light to you. There's nowhere you can go to hide yourself from the presence of God. And that's what I find funny about in the book of Genesis when Adam sins. This is the story of the fall of man. Adam sins and God comes into the garden and he says, Adam, where are you? He knew where Adam was. He couldn't hide from him. What God was doing was trying to restore communication that Adam felt a lack of confidence to have. He always knew where he was at, right? This verse clearly indicates to us that all things are in the presence of God. I'm about to say something that's going to rock your world. It's going to rock your world, right? I want to read to you the second line of that verse in the New King James. If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, you're there. Yeah. It's easy for us to believe that God's in heaven. But how do we accept the fact that God owns hell? Huh? I mean, do you think Jesus is going to go into a place that he ain't going to take ownership of? When Jesus dies on the cross, the Bible says that he went down into hell. He led the captivities captive. He then went over and busted up the devil. He made a display of him openly, it says, and that he took from him the keys. Keys indicates ownership. He took the keys of death, hell, and the grave. He then rose victorious. He says, I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of death, hell, and the grave. And then he looks to us and he says, so thou go under the authority and power that I gave you. I just wonder, don't raise your hand, don't shout it out, but how many of you have ever made your bed in hell before? My mama said it like this, son, you made your bed, now lay in it. Huh? How many of us have made bad decisions that we then had to deal with? And God says, I was there. When you made your biggest mistake that you think that ruined your life, I was there. I was there in that moment. No, you weren't. I was. I was there. Just because of your lack of awareness of his presence does not negate the fact that his presence was there. We're gonna build into this. We're gonna build into this. God is saying, I am here. I am there. You cannot escape the presence of God. Let's just think about this literally for a moment. The Bible says that he holds the world in the palm of his hand. How is his presence not always all around? Something that he is all-encompassing, how could he not be there? You cannot run from his spirit. You cannot hide from his presence. This is the heartbeat behind Coram Deo. Not only the fact that his presence is always there, but acknowledging that and giving him space and room to operate in our lives. But I will tell you this, we can ignore it. We can ignore his presence. We can be distracted from his presence. We could get so busy about life that we don't realize he is here, moving in this place. Well, then how come I don't feel nothing? Because you're not aware. It doesn't mean that he's not here. It just means you're not aware he's here. You could have somebody right next to you having a moment with God where he's refreshing and renewing something within them, and you're like, dag, I don't feel jack. It's because you're not aware. It doesn't mean he's not there. Come on. Watch this, Proverbs 15:3. The eyes of the Lord are in every place, keeping watch on the evil and the good. You scared yet? You scared yet? Maybe you were raised in the kind of church that was very legalistic or very fear-driven. You better be careful. The eyes of the Lord are seeking to and fro. That God sees you. God sees what you're doing, so you better be careful. You better watch yourself. Better behave. And I feel that we equate God Almighty to a police officer on the highway. You're driving along. You're having a good time. You're enjoying life. And you see a police car parked in the median of the highway. Immediately, you gotta hit the brake. You're not even speeding. You're not even doing anything wrong. But there's this fear, I gotta hit the brake. I gotta slow down. And then for the next 2 miles, looking in the rearview mirror. And as cool, calm, and collected as you think you are, you know you do it. You know, you every time you pass a police officer on the highway, you know you look in your rearview mirror for no reason. The officer who is stationed there, his job is to protect and serve, cause fear in your life. And that's what we equate God to. A God that says, I'm here to protect and serve you, we've become afraid of. And so and I don't know how this happened. I don't know how someone reads this verse that says, God's eyes are forever watching, why that became a bad thing. why that became a fearful thing, why that became a judgmental thing, instead of saying, God's always watching out for my best interest. God is forever watching to protect me. The Bible says that he watches over his word to perform it, not to punish. Come on, somebody. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. For Jesus did not come into the world to condemn the world, but through him the world might be saved. He says, I sent this and my eyes are forever watching to protect you. The truth of the matter is when we stand back and say, well, you know, if God is always there, then how come bad stuff happens? Because we live in an evil world. Let's just look at it for a second. Let's just say, hypothetically, 25% of the time that you make a bad decision and you think God is the golden calf that's going to bail you out, huh? You don't actually include him until the problem is there. All right, let's just look at this for a second. How come God didn't protect me? Protect you from what? 55 years of bad eating habits? And now that you're sick, you want the golden calf to come in and heal you? It's going to take some time. That's going to take some time to reverse the insulin resistance. It's going to take some time to get your blood sugar low. It's going to take some exercise and doing what we're supposed to do as human beings. Come on, man. Come on, man. Right? But where was God? He was right where you left him. I'm right there. Include me. Invite me into your decision. Invite me into your moment. I'm right here. But we want to go make decisions and say, you got my back? Now, God, I want you to bless what I decided. Come on. There's this belief in the Christian world, you better be careful because God is watching. And for someone to tell me that actually brings me confidence, not fear. God's watching over his word to perform in my life. God's watching over that everything I set my hands to would prosper and be successful. All right, let's watch this. 1 John 4:18. There's no fear in love. There's no fear in love. So husbands that are afraid of their wives. Me too. There's no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear because fear has to do with punishment. God dealt with the sin problem. He put the punishment upon Jesus on the cross. There's now no fear in love. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. God doesn't want us to live in fear. God wants us to live in love. We romanticize being in love. We all want to be in love. You connect with another human being because you feel that you felt in love. But we're not talking about the butterflies in the belly. We're not talking about the infatuation draw to one another. We're not talking about the lust for one another's bodies. That's not the love in love we're talking about here. We're talking about operating in love, which prefers others before ourselves. This living in love is not losing your mind when someone cuts you off on the highway. Let's just think about that for a second, all right? Because this is what I have to do. Because I have a tendency to be a little hothead, a little road rage. Someone cuts me off on the highway. What do I want to do? I want to tailgate them like 3 inches from their bumper, flashing my brights, let them know, hey, what's up? I'm here. You cut me off, right? But so then I have to play a scenario in my mind. They cut me off and they're speeding like that because one of their loved ones was just taken to intensive care at the hospital. I don't know why they are driving irresponsibly. I don't know. That's walking in love, saying, I'm going to think the best of someone. Come on. That's what he's saying here. In love. And if we're not walking in love, then we're not made we haven't been perfected in God. That's what he's saying here. We're talking about coram deo, love. This presence of God, love. Has anybody seen the movie Extremely Loud and Incredibly Close? Man, same thing, first service. Like two people saw it. I'm telling you right now, it's one of the best movies of your life. Now you got to see it. I generally don't cry at movies. I generally hold back the tears. Bambi was an exception. Bambi was messed up. I'm watching this movie, right? Incredibly close, extremely loud, incredibly close. And come on, guys, you know, you're holding it back, but then your throat starts burning. Your throat's burning real bad. You reach for the glass of water just to kind of like get the knot out of your throat. And I'm holding it back. And all of a sudden, I cry. Oh my God. This movie gets you like that bad. Don't watch it alone. Don't watch it alone. You need somebody to hug. Tom Hanks is in this movie. Tom Hanks perishes in the World Trade Center on 9/11. His son was home when he called, and the son suffers with autism. His son didn't answer the phone. His son is sitting there listening to recording after recording of his dad calling home, and eventually on the last calling, it's disconnected. He never did pick up the phone to talk to his dad. His dad and him would do these scavenger hunts and search for things. And there's a scene in the movie where Linda Shell, played by Sandra Bullock, and her son Oscar Shell, played by Thomas Horn, that they're in this conversation, they're in this moment where he's saying back to her, like, you don't know how I feel. You don't know what I'm going through. You don't know what this is like for me. And she comes back to him and she's like, yes, I do. And she explains to him how she knows it. And actually, I have a clip for you. I want you to see it, and then I'll explain it.
I promise I'll be better soon. I promise. I'll be normal.
That is the last thing that I would want. You are perfect.
I tried incredibly hard, Mom. I know how I could have tried any harder.
I know you did. I know you did. I know you did.
You don't know.
I do.
But you really don't know, Mom.
I know how proud your dad would have been that you didn't stop looking. Sweetie, do you think I would ever let you out of my sight? Do you think I would let anything happen to you? I always knew where you were. Always.
So when he comes, maybe you guys could let him sit on that.
What about Leanne Black?
She yelled at me to go away.
Yeah, me too.
Whether or not you had any connection to... Go. Please,
she must be in New York.
Go.
So you knew about the key?
Mm-hmm. I knew you had to go make sense of things. And I got to go with you.
I wonder how many of us, when I was writing this about Coram Deo in the presence of God, this was the scene that came back into my mind because it was so etched in my mind that I felt like this moment of him talking to his mom was kind of like how many of us talk to God. God, I'm trying so hard. God, you don't even know how hard I'm trying to be good. God, you don't know how hard I'm trying to have faith. You don't know how hard I'm trying to find the belief, to find my hope in you. And God is sit back saying, I know. Are you trying to convince me or are you trying to convince you? It's like, yeah, but you don't know. You don't know. And then she says it. Do you think I would ever let you out of my sight? Do you think I wouldn't know where you were at all times? This being an evil woman, she's a human being. Cares this much for her child, how much more is your heavenly Father watching over you. The scene here, this scene, we cut it all up, but this scene shows that she went to every house before he did. And he says, and she told him, my son's going to come here. And when he does, can you talk to him? See, because God goes before you and he makes ways for you. He goes ahead of you and he sets. There's other scenes where he's walking down the street and his mom is like a half a block behind following him in a car. And then he's standing there talking to people and she's hiding behind a tree. Just because you don't acknowledge the presence of God doesn't mean you are far from his sight. This is Coram Deo. God is right there. He's in your midst. And he's saying to you, I see you. I'm right here. And he's not saying, I see you in a way like, I see you, better behave. That's not at all what he's saying. He's saying, I'm here. I can help you. Would you invite me? Would you invite me? Would you bring me into your decision-making opportunities? He's not angry, but he's there for your protection because he loves you. Yeah, but I don't understand the whole how God could be in hell because that's where you chose to go. And he is with you. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I am as close to you as the mention of my name. I will stick closer to you than a brother. He said, the Bible says, I have sealed you with a promise of the Holy Spirit until the day of redemption. How do you think you can break the seal that you didn't make? This is beyond a Ziploc baggie, baby. The Holy Spirit says, I have sealed you with a promise until the day of redemption. You didn't make the seal. You can't break the seal. He says, I'm right here. I won't run from you. This series that we're in is going to look a little bit different than other series. I normally write a series. I have a theme, and then I have four parts that kind of revolve around the theme. This one's going to be a little bit different. Today, this series is going to look like a Netflix series. This is going to be one sermon that's divided into four parts. So for those that can't make it on a Sunday or whatever, you can binge watch the series, and it will make sense from beginning to end in one story, okay? I will say this. I want to throw this out there to you right now. Next week is one of those sermons you do not want to miss being in the room. If you're watching online, you can't get the experience that we're going to have in the room online. Okay? And I don't mean this in any weird way, but there's going to be an interactive moment where you can get out of your seat and participate in something. You can't have that experience online. All right? So that's where we're going with this. This week is one of those setup weeks for really what I want to share next week. You've ever watched a Netflix series and you're like, man, all these sermons are great. This one was just kind of like not as great, but it was a setup week for the following. And that's what this week is, all right? So here's what I want to get to today. Here's the setup to get to where we're at. In the book of beginnings, the book of Genesis, there's a story of a man named Jacob. In Genesis 28:10, it says this, Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. Now, Jacob is under the instructions of his father Isaac. Isaac said, do not marry a Canaanite woman, but marry someone in our bloodline. And so he is on a mission through obedience to his father to go get a wife, okay? When he reached a certain place, and it's no certain place for any particular reason, he just stopped there because it was nighttime, the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head, and he lay down to sleep. I got to tell you, I've spent a lot of money on pillows this year trying to find the right pillow, and I must have got it all wrong. I got to use a rock. I could have saved a bunch of money just went in my backyard and got a stone. Right? So he put the stone under his head, made it as a pillow. Genesis 28, 12. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven. And the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. There above it stood the Lord. And the Lord said to him, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth. That means there are going to be a lot of them. And you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All peoples on the earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you, and I will watch over you. What? Wherever you go. He didn't say wherever I micromanage you to go. Come on. He said, I'll be with you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land, and I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised. This entire passage, and we're going to get to a little bit more in a second, is a promise that God gave me late at the end of 2019. I took a weekend off, and I went away to be with the Lord, and he took me into this passage and began to show me some things about what our calling was as a church, and that's where I got the phrase Coram Deo. It was during that time of prayer. As I'm asking the question right now, the first Sunday of a new decade, the first Sunday of the year, 2020, do you have a promise from God for this year? Because right here, God promises him, I will do exactly what I promised you. I will do what I promised you. I will do what I promised you. I will fulfill my promise to you. I think I need to put a challenge to you to spend some time with God to find what his promise for your new year is. What's God going to do in your new year? What's God got in store for your 2020? See, God says to him, I'm the God of your granddad and I'm the God of your dad. But I want you to know that I'm not your God just because of your dad and your granddad. I'm your God because I chose you. I need you to understand today that God chose you. You think you chose Christianity, but God chose you. He needs somebody in 2020. He needs someone in this decade to make a difference to your circle of influence. He then tells them, I'm giving you the land that you're lying on. There's some people in here who you have a dream of owning your own home. You got it. You already got kind of the dream and the picture and whatever it is. You got a dream of owning a business. You got a dream of owning something. Are you getting in the car and driving the streets on which you want to live? Are you taking pictures of homes and the kind of house that you want? Are you making real estate appointments to go see houses that are for sale and you ain't got no money yet? See, because that's how we walk by faith and not by sight. My feet got to walk on something. My feet got to walk on something that I'm going to own. My feet got to get in there, man. Before I ever owned a home, I was driving up and down streets saying, one day I'm going to own a home. I'm going to own a home. And I'd get out. I'd make real estate appointments. I'd go see mansions that I could, in my mind, never, ever afford in my entire life. Whatever. My real estate agent hated me. I finally said, hey, can you just get like an approval letter from the bank? No, I don't. I got no money. I got no money. Why, you're wasting my time. No, sir. You're wasting my time. No, sir. I got a vision. I got no money, but I got vision. Man, Pastor Mike, you just sound stupid. I'll be stupid all day long. I'll be stupid, I'll be blessed. Come on. I'm giving you the land that you're lying on. The dude did nothing to own it, but obey his dad. He obeyed his dad. He was about his dad's business. He laid down because he was sleeping. I said, oh, by the way, This land you're laying on, yeah, it's yours. Now look to the east. All that's yours. Look to the west. That's all yours. Look to the north. That's all yours. Look to the south. That's all yours. It's all yours. It's all yours. Why, God? Because you're all mine. Because you're all mine. I can remember the day that we found our first house. It was this little tiny 1,300 square foot ranch built in 1949 and hadn't been updated one day since it was built. We walked inside. It smelled like 1949. I walk in that house. And they even had to like make me sign a waiver because the guy who had previously owned it died in it. Whole story. I walk in the house. I said, oh, please, God, no. Let this not be the house that you have for me. But as soon as I stepped inside the house, I knew right here, this is your house. This is your house. I got this inward knowing. It's kind of what we say here at Family Church. I got this inward knowing. I didn't have a vision like Jacob, but I knew in here that when I stepped on that property, that it was mine. And I needed that promise. Let me throw this out. I needed that promise for what was going to come. Well, Mr. McKelvey, we know that you want this house, but there's already three other cash offers on the house. Plus, the septic system failed. It's going to need a whole new septic system. Plus, there's radon. Plus, you know, blah, blah, blah. All these things that were stacked against us. I was like, yeah, but I know. But I know this is mine. Yeah, but it don't look good because this person got cash. Yeah, I get that. But I know. You dumb little kid. You don't realize who you're bidding against. No, no, no. You don't realize. You don't realize, and it was my Abraham-Isaac moment. Abraham is taking his son Isaac up a mountain to sacrifice his son. And while Abraham and Isaac were walking up one side of the mountain, the ram, the provision, was walking up the other side of the mountain. They never saw it. You see, God was working a deal for me that I didn't know that I even had faith for, because they had to take everything off the price of the house. They take the septic system off the price of the house and the radon off the price of the house and all these things. And I got to mortgage it. Listen, so I got to move into this house with everything fixed, nothing out of pocket. But I had a promise. I had a knowing. I saw the beauty in the mess. Jacob's headed in this direction. Watch what happens in Genesis 28:16. When Jacob awoke, say he awoke. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it. If you came in here today and you said, okay, yeah, the music was okay, but I hadn't feel nothing from God. I didn't feel the presence of God nowhere. You might be sleeping. And 2020 might be your year to get awoke. 2020 might be your year to wake up to the presence of God. If you can't say, surely the presence of God was here today, that either means you didn't bring him with you, or you're asleep to the fact that his presence is here. Come on. He was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. Come on, this is the promise that God gave me for this year. Family Church would be the house of God, a gate of heaven. Early the next morning, Jacob took his pillow. He took the stone that he had placed under his head, and he set it as a pillar. He set it as a monument, and he poured oil on top of it, and he called the place Bethel, though the city used to be called Luz. He had to rename the place. He had to rename the place. The name Bethel means house of God. Turn to the person next to you, wake up. Turn to your second choice, say, wake up. And if you refuse to say it at all because you're introverted, tell yourself, wake up. What do you find yourself asleep to? What do you need to awaken to? And that's kind of a trick question, because if you're asleep to it, you don't know what you're asleep to. 2020 may be a year of spiritual growth for you. We created a 30-day spiritual meal plan We have a digital version of it on our website, right under the main header. We also have one printed out. We have gone through, I don't even know how many hundreds of copies so far. They're printing more right now, but we printed a paperback version of a 28-day spiritual meal plan. It's the book of Acts. So you read a chapter of the book of Acts, and then you do the devotional that goes with it. So today would be day 5. We're all trying to be doing the exact same thing on the same day. If we're in conversations, we all know what we just read today. We're all reading the same thing. We're all having the same examples to talk about, all right? That might be the first step and the start for what 2020 looks like to you, Coram Deo, right? Jacob was asleep to the fact that the Lord was with him. Now, you don't need to say anything. You don't need to shout out, but do you know that the Lord is in this place? Are you aware of the presence of the Lord wherever you go? Do you give him his place in your decision making? Do you give him his place in your struggle? I have a homework assignment for you. Because of next week and the importance of next week and how big I believe next week is going to be, I need you to do something. We're going to have an interactive message where I hope you'd be willing to get out of your seat and do something. We're going to kind of reformat the service, so come early, come on time. If you're late, I'll already be preaching, all right? So if you're the person who's not really into worship, great, come on time. We're not going to do a whole lot of worship at the beginning, okay? We're going to save it for a moment at the end. But you have homework. I need you to take time and pray this week, and I want you to name 2020. I want you to name what this year is to you. What is God leading you into for 2020? I've already got some text messages in where people have already got a name that they're naming 2020. If maybe it's clean and sober, maybe that's something that you need to work on for 2020. Maybe it's debt free. Maybe it's more than enough. Right? If I talk to you about finances, right? So let's just say you're in debt. There's a place between being in debt and being financially free called the land of even, right? So if you're in debt, you got to first get to the land of even, then you go to the land that's more than enough. You're only in the land of even for 2 seconds, because the second you pay off your bills and you get your next paycheck, you're in the land that's more than enough, all right? I could do a whole series on that if you want, but maybe it's finances. Maybe you need financial freedom. Maybe it's something in your marriage. Maybe it's something with your children. Maybe it's healthy and whole. Right, maybe you've been dealing with health problems. Whatever it is, next week when you come in, I need you to bring on a piece of paper what you're naming 2020. I'm not going to keep it. It's yours, but I want you to bring it, because your interaction, you're not going to say anything on the microphone. I'm not going to embarrass you, but your interaction needs that name. So pray about it. Pray about it. All right, and in your prayer time, say something like this. If you're taking notes, you can go back and watch this online. Lord, I pray that you open the eyes of my understanding, enlighten me to your truth, show me things to come. What would you have me name 2020? What would you like to do in my life? What would you do through me this year? What do I need to fix? What do I need to change? All right? What do I need to change? That's the hardest prayer you could ever ask God. What do I need to change? Because you may not like his answer. All right? You may not like his answer. As we close out today, the beginning of 2020, I want to pray that you would have wisdom as to what this year looks like to you. I honestly could tell you I only know what this sermon series looks like. But I have an urgency in my spirit to bring an awakening to the presence of God. Right? I believe next week, I'll be honestly transparent. I believe next week will forever change how we do Sunday church. I think the design element and the structure, you guys know, we come in, we do 3 or 4 songs, then we do announcements, then we take offering. I believe all that next week's going to change what this looks like moving forward, okay? I believe that there's a lot of men who aren't into worship, so we're going to get that out of the way. Right? We're not going to make this so that people have to stand through something that they don't enjoy. But at the end of service, when we do worship, it'll be interactive worship. Because I believe people worship differently. I believe the American church was designed more for women than it was for men. And that we've been trying to force men to worship the way that women do. And so we're going to design some worship elements that men can participate in that look different. I'm just throwing some big vision out, right? And if you're not really up with change, this isn't a change, this is a tweak. All right? It's a tweak. I believe for us to experience the presence of God, then we have to be able to worship God in our own way. And so we're going to create some elements for that. So I believe this was a spiritual moment today. I believe the presence of God was here, but I know what next week is going to be. So don't miss it. If you're watching online, don't miss next week. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. I pray that as we leave here today and as we take some time to find out what we're going to name 2020, maybe it's for somebody in here this year, it's your million year. It's your millionaire year. You're going to become a millionaire. Whatever it is, God, I pray that you give us wisdom to name it according to your will and according to your plan and your design for our lives. Help us to not think small, but to dream big. Help us to have a dream that outlasts our life and that leaves a legacy for the next generation. I pray, God, that we start this decade in a way that's less of us and more of you. If you're here today and you've never had an opportunity to make Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, we'd like to pray with you today. If you've never submitted your life to Jesus, if you never became a Christian, we make it very simple. We pray a prayer. We accept Jesus into our heart, to our life. And we'd love to pray that with you today. And we all pray it together. It goes this: Dear God, I come to you just like I am. I believe that Jesus Christ is my Lord and my Savior. Jesus, I invite you into my life to change me and to make me new. Thank you for accepting me. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Could I just take 2 more seconds? If you prayed that prayer for the very first time today, could I take a second and celebrate you? Could you just wave at me real quick and say, hey, that was me. I prayed for the first time. All right, man, I see you. Anybody else real quick? All right, I see you. Anybody else? Over there, I see you. Awesome. Awesome. Back there, all right, I see you. Awesome. Right here, yeah, I see you. Amen. Awesome. So you guys are really lucky. We created a brand new book for today called Starting Point. Starting Point is a 6-day devotional that walks you through your first 6 days as a believer in Jesus. You read the passage, you read some content, and then you do what it says. And it's really cool. We've got a video series that's going to come with it, so you can watch the video and then do the workbook with it. We're super excited about it. That is available for you at the High Top tables right here in the back of this room. Just say, hey, I raised my hand today. Can I get the Starting Point book? And you can get that today. Amen? Father, we thank you for today that your word will never return to you void. It will accomplish exactly what you set it forth to do. Lord, we are so excited for what you have in store for this year in your presence, before your eyes. So, Lord, we give you this week. We give you our attention. We give you our motives. We give you the direction that you would have us to go this week. Lead us. Guide us into all truth. Lord, I bless everyone the sound of my voice. They're the head and not the tail above, never beneath. Everything they set their hands to will prosper and be successful. In Jesus' name, amen. Love you.